special welcome this morning to those people who are visiting us. So welcome to our guests. A few announcements that I want to bring to your attention. The first announcement is next Saturday, May 4th at 10 o'clock, Church Landscape Committee. So that we are actually forming a committee about not only doing the spring cleanup, but then also talking about any of the landscaping that needs to go on. If you're interested in serving on the Landscape Committee, we welcome you to be here then next Saturday at 10. A couple other announcements. Sunday, May 12th will be the last day of Sunday school. And then on Sunday, May 19th, we begin our summer worship schedule. So then our worship begins at 9:30 on Sunday, May 19th. I believe that is it for announcements, and I believe we're ready now for service.
Thank you, Terry. Good morning. We're a little hot there. Are we okay? Okay. Good to have all of you here. Special day as we move into spring, although it seems like we regressed a little bit weather-wise from a week ago, didn't we? But that will come around. Good to have you here. Special day today. It's a busy time of year, and we're just honoring those who are graduating from high school this year, and that'll come a little bit later in our service. But glad to have all of you here this morning as we share in that celebration, but even beyond that, in just the celebration of the resurrection that we celebrate every Sunday. So I'm going to open our service this morning with these words from Psalm 25. David says, "Indeed, Lord, none who wait for you will be put to shame. Make me know your ways. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation." Father, thank you that you are willing to lead if we're willing to follow. So God, give us the faith and the vision to always have you before us and to have our eyes fixed on you. And Lord, as we worship you this morning, let it be from our hearts, not just our lips. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to open by singing of His Amazing Grace. This is a little bit more contemporary version. My chains are gone because His grace sets you free. So let's sing together and let's sing out.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lord God, that you have set us free, that the sin in which we still live and move every day no longer has a hold on us, because you have defeated it. And it's to your grace that we appeal, and in your grace that we stand. Amen. You would turn to your bulletin to our confession of our need for that grace. Please read along with me. Gracious God, we confess that we have longed too much for the comforts of this world. We have loved the gifts more than the giver. In your mercy, help us to see that all the things we pine for are shadows, but you are substance, that they are quicksands, but you are mountains, that they are shifting, but you are anchor. We plead your forgiveness on the merits of Jesus Christ. Accept his worthiness for our unworthiness, his sinlessness for our transgressions, his fullness for our emptiness, his glory for our shame, his righteousness for our dead works, his death for our life. We pray in Jesus' name. This time of our prayers for the church, we're gonna open this time by first praying for our graduating high school seniors. So I'm gonna call them. You've been looking at some of their pictures and information perhaps before we started our worship time. So if Paisley and Tracy and Laura and Jacob would come forward and just stand before us here, and then also Jeremy Mindering for just to present a card and congratulations to them. And I just warned them that they had to come. Well, why don't we wait just a second? We'll do that at the end, Jeremy. Well, hold, control yourself. No, you stand. I just warned them they were going to come up here as they came in this morning, so sorry about that. I figured they might not show if I told them too early. But it's a big deal, graduation from high school, because everything, so much opens up now in your lives. And it's so critical that as you now move forward at this time in your life, that you know that God is leading you. Because, wow, it's a big world, and it's a dangerous world, and it's a fatal world if God isn't in it with us. So that's why we're here this morning, and I know you guys know that, but we're just going to have a special prayer and ask God to just take hold of your futures and guide them and protect you along the way. So I would ask, congregation, would you pray with us? Heavenly Father, standing before us this morning, and more importantly, standing before you right now, are these four about-to-be high school graduates. And Lord, in the weeks and months and years ahead, they're going to be broadening the boundaries of their lives in terms of their life experience, but also in terms of relationships, in terms of opportunities. They'll be encountering many crossroads in their lives, Lord, not just crossroads of career, but even more importantly, crossroads of character. Times when they'll have to decide whether or not to take the path that most glorifies you, even if it means being less successful or lesser known in the eyes of others. So in these days of easily discarded relationships, Lord, help them to know what it means to be a faithful friend and husband or wife or father or mother. In the days that sometimes seem so frantic, help them to know your peace, which you say passes all understanding. In these days when they will have to navigate seas of change and even crises, help them to forge anchors of wisdom out of every disappointment. Give them a heart to pass that wisdom on one day to their children. Oh God, may they never lack passion for you. Give them a spirit that pursues you above everything else. Because we know, Lord, at the end of the day, it's not about making our mark, but pressing on to your mark, and pressing on to that prize for which Paul strained. The moment when the Master says, well done, and the forever that we will have knowing you face to face. So, Lord, we entrust these graduates into your purpose, into your protection, into your keeping, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Jeremy just has a card and a small gift that he'd like to give you, and congratulations, Jacob. I've got a cold hand still. Congratulations, Tracy. Congratulations, Laura. Congratulations. And let's congratulate them. All right, let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you again for the privilege. And Lord, it's a privilege that we take for granted far too often. So thank you, God, for the intentional focus time that we have just to know that our prayers ascend in a way that is truly supernatural from this earth into the very throne room, your very throne room in heaven. So God, we thank you that you hear us today and your heart goes out to every situation. And Lord, you speak and provide for every need. And Lord, we ask that before we even present these needs before you, that you give us wisdom to understand and faith to believe that our ways are not always your ways, that your ways are as much higher than our ways as the heavens are above the earth. So, Lord, we continue to pray for those who are battling various illnesses. We think of Ian Oxford and Eileen Huseman, who are both battling infections within their body and in their blood. God, we know that these can be very serious and even life-threatening. So we ask, God, for your hand of healing, your touch of healing upon their bodies. Thank you for the faith that is in both of these people. And Lord, keep their eyes on you during whatever path this takes for them. We pray, God, that it would be a path into strength and healing and continuing testimony of your grace and goodness. Father, we pray for those who are battling cancer. We think of Jean Hortness and Teresa Benson. And Lord, there are many others who are going through the same battle. God, we again entrust them into your keeping and your protection and your healing power. God, show your grace and your love in ways that are beyond what we can even imagine. God, our request for them is that you would bring complete healing. And we know you are able. We believe that all things are possible. And God, we ask you for that. And those, Lord, who have fought that battle and according to the world's eyes have lost it, but according to your eyes have gained the ultimate victory. We think of the family of Jill Ollinger, the family of Stacy and the staff at the dental clinic here in town, who are feeling so closely the pain of this loss. God, I pray that you would come into those situations and into those families and into those meeting places and bring light and hope and yes, even joy and reminder, Lord, of what we celebrated specifically last week that rings true every day of our lives through eternity, that because you died and rose again, we too will rise to newness of life. Father, we pray for those who are around the world spreading your word, many of them in danger, but trusting that they're in your hands and that nothing can be done outside of what you would allow. We think of those in the Gideons. We think of Gordon this morning as he's sharing the work of the Gideons. We pray a blessing on that message and upon the response to it, with the ultimate vision, Lord, of your word reaching not just the hands but the hearts of many people around the world and transforming darkness into light and death into life. And then, Lord, we pray for those who are going through celebrations and milestone events in their lives. Again, these graduates right here in our midst, we think of others graduating in different contexts, whether it's college or some other context. God, be their light. Be the light unto their path, as your word says. And give them purpose and vision. We think of those celebrating birthdays. We think of Landon, about to be 9. We think of Marshall, today, celebrating a birthday. God, bless them and show your goodness and your grace into their lives and into their families, into their homes. And Lord, we pray for wisdom and guidance and protection for our nation, for our leaders, our president. We ask, God, for truth to guide and for hearts and minds to be open to it. And we pray for your people in the city of Jerusalem and the peace of Jerusalem, knowing, God, that you say all who pray for them will be blessed. And Lord, we acknowledge we need and want your blessing. It is our life. All these things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you need a prayer slip to be prayed for this week and to be in the drawing for the names, Rob has those names. And Noel will have the box in the back as you go out. Don't forget to pick one up if you put one in. Also, then we'll ask our ushers to come forward at this time to receive our tithes and our offerings. Seated. If you would look in your bulletin to our confession, these words of faith taken from Peter's first letter, and please respond according to the bold print. Like newborn infants, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up into salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. We ourselves, like living stones, are being built up as a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ.
We are a
Once we were not a people, but now we are God's people. Once we had not received mercy, but now we have received mercy. Amen. I'll call on Marcia Cumlin for our scripture readings today.
Good morning. The Old Testament lesson can be found in the book of Isaiah, chapter 30, verses 19 to 21. O people in Zion, inhabitant in Jerusalem, you will weep no longer. He will surely be gracious to you at the sound of your cry. When he hears it, he will answer you. Although the Lord has given you bread of privation and water of oppression, he, your teacher, will no longer hide himself, but your eyes will behold your teacher. Your ears will hear a word behind you. This is the way, walk in it, whenever you turn to the right or to the left. The New Testament lesson can be found in Romans chapter 8, verses 1 to 8. Deliverance from bondage. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For what the law could not do, weak as it was through the flesh, God did, sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh and as an offering for sin. He condemned sin in the flesh, so that the requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who are according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who are according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For the mind set on the flesh is death, but the mind set on the Spirit is life and peace. Because the mind set on the flesh is hostile toward God, for it does not subject itself to the law of God, for it is not even able to do so. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. And the gospel reading can be found in the book of Mark, chapter 9, verses 14 to 41. Please rise if you are able. All things possible. When they came back to the disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and some scribes arguing with them. Immediately, when the entire crowd saw him, they were amazed and began running up to greet him. And he asked them, "What are you discussing with them?" And one of the crowd answered him, "Teacher, I brought you my son, possessed with a spirit which makes him mute. And whenever it seizes him, it slams him to the ground, and he foams at the mouth, and grinds his teeth and stiffens out. I told your disciples to cast it out, and they could not do it." And he answered them and said, "O unbelieving generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I put up with you? Bring him to me." They brought the boy to him. When he saw him, immediately the spirit threw him into a convulsion, and falling to the ground, he began rolling around and foaming at the mouth. And he asked his father, "How long has this been happening to him?" And he said, "From childhood. It has often thrown him both into the fire and into the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us." And Jesus said to him, "If you can, all things are possible to him who believes." Immediately the boy's father cried out and said, "I do believe. Help my unbelief." When Jesus saw that a crowd was rapidly gathering, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, "You deaf and mute spirit, I command you, come out of him and do not enter him again." After crying out and throwing him into terrible convulsions, it came out, and the boy became so much like a corpse that most of them said, "He is dead." But Jesus took him by the hand and raised him, and he got up. When he came into the house, his disciples began questioning him privately, "Why could we not drive it out?" And he said to them, "This kind cannot come out by anything but prayer." So the death and resurrection foretold. From there they went out and began to go through Galilee, and he did not want anyone to know about it. For he was teaching his disciples and telling them, "The Son of Man is to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And when he has been killed, he will rise 3 days later." But they did not understand this statement, and they were afraid to ask him. They came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he began to question them, "What were you discussing on the way?" But they kept silent, for on the way they had discussed with one another which of them was the greatest. Sitting down, he called the 12 and said to them, "If anyone wants to be first, he shall be last of all and servant of all." Taking a child, he set him before them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one child like this in my name receives me, and whoever receives me does not receive me, but him who sent me." and dire warnings. John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name, and we tried to prevent him because he was not following us." But Jesus said, "Do not hinder him, for there is no one who will perform a miracle in my name and be able soon afterward to speak evil of me. For he who is not against us is for us. For whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because of your name as followers of Christ, truly I say to you, he will not lose his reward." And here ends the Holy Gospel.
Thank you, Marcia. You can be seated. We're going to call on our choir at this time. I always think Lent is such a busy time of year. There's so much going on, so many extra services and things to plan for, and then you get done with it and suddenly you're in May and it gets busier. But a lot of the busyness is on your end, and the community and the families and things going on this time of year. High school, college students, as we know, making plans that will impact the rest of their lives, where you're headed, what your goals are, how you're going to achieve those goals, all of those things on your mind. But I want to throw another question into the mix, and this question isn't just for graduates, it's for all of us, okay? Here's the question. Would you be able to write out, or if you're on your computer, to type out in a sentence or two what you believe God's purpose is for your life? Would you be able to do that if that were your assignment and you had to turn that in? And I would ask you to even narrow the focus of that so that it applies to you personally, not a generic answer, God's purpose is. No, what's His purpose in your life as you've come to acknowledge Him and look to Him and ask Him to guide you up to this point in your life? Do you know what His purpose is? And actually, I think it would be a great idea. I'm not going to have you turn anything in, but it'd be a great idea if we all did that, sat down and wrote that out. Because when we think about what that purpose is and what we believe that is and why we do the things we do, the result is that we become more proactive in how we live our lives rather than just reactive. Reactionary living isn't a good way to live. You know that? Because you're always at the mercy of circumstances, and circumstances are always changing. Nothing predictable, reliable. I mean, I can't think of anything more anxiety-producing in life than living reactionarily, if that's a word. But I think the truth is that that's probably more the norm in people's lives than the exception. You know what? There's a better way to live. There's a better way to live. And God says, I want you to live proactively. Live with a purpose. Live by making decisions based on what you believe your life is about rather than by what happened in the world today. But you know what? If we're going to live this way proactively, then we'd better have a clear sense, a true sense of what our life is about, don't you think? Hence the assignment. And we can start by breaking it down into two pretty basic, simple categories, really. We're either going to live with a godly purpose or a worldly purpose. I mean, everything really falls in the large scale, falls into one of those two categories. You're going to live for God's purpose or according to the world's purpose. From here, it gets a little bit more complicated. Let's say that all of you agree that God does have a purpose. You do have a godly purpose for living, and you want to live out that purpose, okay? That may not be 100% the case for everybody in here, but I don't know. And you're in church, after all, so I'm going to give you the benefit of the doubt that you believe that, okay? The part that begins to get complicated is in the next question. Okay, I believe that God does have a purpose for my life, and I want to live it out. So, am I living out that godly purpose by my flesh, or am I living it out in the Spirit? And here's why I have to ask. There are a lot of Christians who do realize that God has a purpose for their lives, but they're still walking in the flesh completely, or at least partially. And it's not it doesn't have to be a conscious, it usually isn't, a conscious decision to say, I'm going to live my godly purpose out of my flesh. People don't decide to do that. It's just a natural direction if something isn't done to change course. And into that situation, God says, let me teach you a different way, a better way. But then he adds this, he says, but but it requires training. It requires learning how to walk a different way through this life. I mean, Proverbs 16, verse 25 says, "There is a way that seems right unto man." You know that verse. It states it more than once in the book of Proverbs. But you know what seems right to our natural minds is vastly different than what is right to God. Really. And if we don't get beyond what seems right, it'll kill us. I mean, I'm literally, it will kill us. Listen to the rest of that verse. "There is a way that seems right to man, but its end is the way to death." And that's why Paul said in Romans 12, "I appeal to you." And he says, "Brothers, in the faith." So this is when we say, are we living it in the flesh or in the spirit, what we believe by faith. He says, this is a real thing for Christians to deal with. "I appeal to you to do what? To present your bodies before God as a living sacrifice." In other words, give yourselves over to Him. And this is a conscious thing that you have to say, "I'm going to do this." It doesn't happen naturally. Put yourself in a position in life where God can show you not only what His purpose is for you, but how He wants it lived out in your life. He says, don't be conformed to this world. Word of God says it. Don't be conformed to this world. Why not? Because the world is living by what seems right. So God has set before us a way that leads to life. But He says, there's only one way you can walk that path. It's by the Spirit of God who lives in you. You heard Marcia read, "To set the mind on the flesh is death." You heard Marcia read, "Those who are in the flesh cannot please God." So we put ourselves in a position before God. We present our bodies, as Paul says to do. We submit to Him so He can teach us a way that doesn't lead to death. That's what this is about. And believe it or not, it involves your mind. You do have to engage in some thinking in this process. It's not possible to give yourself to God and at the same time to refuse to let go of how you naturally think or how you look at the world or life. It's not possible to give yourself to God and not change what's natural to you. Okay? Paul says, be transformed. How? By renewing your mind. By bringing something different into the way you think about things, into the way you see things. Oh, the world is effective in wanting you and in indoctrinating you into seeing things the way it wants you to see them. God says, don't be conformed to that. Be transformed by renewing how you think. And then He says, here's where the training begins, so that by testing, you may discern what is the will of God. Testing. What does that mean? By testing, it means finding out the worth of something, and in this case, the Word of God. Finding out, is God's Word really worthy of me making this submission, this change in how I look at things? It means putting His Word to use. It means testing it in actual situations that come up in your life. And what does God's Word have to say about some of the social issues of our day? Does it speak to that? What does God's Word have to say about praying in my private life? Yeah, we do that in church, but do I do that the other 6 days of the week? What does God's Word have to say about fasting? How many of you ever think about that? What does God's Word have to say about how you would enter into worship with Him? Or how you should love your neighbor. What does God have to say about building each other up as against tearing each other down so that you get up above them? That's the way of the world. Seems right. What does God's Word have to say about sowing into His kingdom with your gifts, your talents, your tithes? He speaks to that a lot. And trust me, I'm going to do a message on that sometime soon, because the way the world looks at the subject of tithing is so different than how God looks at it. And it's not about blessing Him, your tithing. It's about blessing you. But we'll get into that another Sunday. But God is saying, get into my Word. Get into it. Find out how I want you to live. It's in there. Test it out and see if I won't honor everything that I have said in there, if you'll try it. It's about consciously, intentionally putting ourselves in situations where we can do what God says we should do. And then watch how he responds to it. You know what happens when we do this? We end up growing in our awareness. We end up growing in our faith that God is trustworthy. And gradually our mind starts looking to him. When all these things change all around us, your first natural direction is not to go to him in your nature. But when you start being trained in this new way of living, in this godly way, in walking by the Spirit, gradually your first instinct then becomes to look to him for guidance rather than to the world. It's called renewing our minds. And I'll just say this, graduates, it's not the kind of mind renewing you're going to experience in most colleges, by the way. You got to go through them, and they teach a lot, but keep the foundation. Keep the foundation, because you're going to get exposed to a lot. They're going to challenge everything you've learned about your faith up to this point. But remember, they're looking through eyes of what seems right. Keep that in mind as you go through your training and education. So I'm going to turn our focus for a few minutes to Mark 9, because in this chapter are the very things Jesus was trying to teach his disciples and get them to understand. And you can see in this chapter the tension between what seems right and what God says is right. So the context for what Marcia read is right after the transfiguration of Jesus up on the mountain. So he just comes down from the mountain with Peter, James, and John. And as they come down the mountain, they go into the crowd near the village, and they see the other disciples there arguing. They're in an argument. The NASB that Marcia read says they're in a discussion. The ESV says they're arguing with the scribes. So Jesus walks up to that scene, and he says, "What are you arguing about?" And a man explains about his son that he had brought to his disciples to have a demon cast out of him. And as it turned out, the disciples had not been successful in doing that. And apparently this led to a conversation which turned into an argument with the scribes. Now, there are some things that happened here which speak to purpose. I mean, God's and people's. And we're going to get to that, but I want you to see the thing that was urgent on Jesus' mind. The thing that triggered this sense of urgency was the disciples' inability to exercise authority over the demon in this boy. Here's his response. "O faithless, O unbelieving generation, how long must I be with you? How long do I have to put up with you?" I mean, he's frustrated in his humanness, isn't he? And maybe in his divinity. And he took authority over the demon, as you heard, commanding it to come out of the boy and never return. And then Jesus, the Bible says, he took his disciples away from the towns, away from that crowd, because he needed to be alone with them. Why? Because he knew that his time with them was rapidly coming to a close, and they didn't yet understand his purpose. And if they didn't get his purpose, they certainly were not going to understand their own purpose after he was gone. They weren't anywhere near ready to carry on his message. So he took them to a place where he had some teaching time. Here's what he explained to them. "The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. They're going to kill him. And when he's killed, 3 days later, he's going to rise." Here's what the Bible says. "But they didn't understand and were afraid to ask him." You're probably thinking, "Well, I'd ask him. That wouldn't be hard." But you got to keep in mind, it hadn't been very long before this where Jesus had told them the same thing. And that was the time when Peter challenged him. Remember? And he said, "Lord, never. This won't ever happen to you." And Jesus rebuked Peter. Remember what he said? "Get behind me, Satan." And that kind of shook him. And the other disciples, apparently. And there was this whole purpose issue again. Jesus said to Peter, "For you're setting your mind not on the things of God, but on the things of man." They were focused, even the disciples still at this point, on what seems right. So with that memory fresh in their minds, nobody dared ask him again after he told them what was going to happen. Now, the situation gets worse with them before it gets better. Okay? If Jesus were exasperated with them before this teaching session, after that argument with the scribes, I wonder how he felt after what happened next. They're done with the private teaching time. They're on their way to Capernaum on the north shore of the Sea of Galilee. You'd think, okay, they're walking, they've got this opportunity, great opportunity to just discuss among themselves everything Jesus had just told them and really pound it into their minds. Who wouldn't take that opportunity? Well, they didn't. What were they doing? They were in another argument about who was the greatest disciple. That's what they were doing on the way to Capernaum. I mean, wouldn't you like to have heard the conversation that took place the next time Jesus went away to be with his Father? Father, how long are they ever going to get it? So let's break this down. Here's what the disciples did understand. They understood that Jesus is the Son of God. They understood that demons were subject to him, even to his name. They understood that Jesus had power over things that hold people in bondage. But there were things they didn't understand, important things. They didn't yet understand the purpose for which he came into this world. Every time he brought it up, they bristled. They didn't understand the difference between a temporary freedom from bondage, such as casting out a demon, or an eternal freedom. They didn't understand how to walk the pathway to true greatness. Serving others as a way to achieving greatness didn't seem right to them. And it all comes back to what we talked about as we began. For them, for us, to understand the purpose of God, our minds need to be moved away from what seems right toward what God says is right. It's going to be rough in the early stages of that transformation. It doesn't happen automatically. It won't happen automatically. It doesn't come with age. It doesn't happen by going to school or getting a job. It doesn't happen by attending church once a week. It comes by spending time with the Lord, intentionally making time to do this and allowing his word to speak to us. It comes by asking intentionally in that time with the Lord, asking the Holy Spirit to give me, Holy Spirit, understanding as I'm reading your word, because in my flesh I don't get it. And when the disciples asked Jesus why they weren't able to cast out the demon, he said, this kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer. In other words, there are powers at work in this world that are really strong. And the only way that their purpose will not prevail over our lives is if we're spending time with the Lord and growing in our understanding of his purpose, so that we speak forth and we live out that purpose. And there's an all-important result that takes place when you spend time with God. Do you know that? The more time you spend with him, the greater this result, and that result is faith. A powerful thing, church. Faith is a powerful thing. If we are vacillating in our minds between what seems right to us and what God says is right, do you think we're going to see God's purpose fulfilled if faith isn't built up in it? I mean, James 1 says that we're to ask God in faith without doubting. Verse 7 goes on to say, if someone is vacillating, that person must not even suppose that he'll receive anything from the Lord. He's a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways, torn between what seems right and what God says is right. And the further that goes in your spending time with the Lord, the more what God says is right becomes natural to you. Now, the father of this demon-possessed boy shows some signs of that double-mindedness. After he saw that the disciples weren't able to do what he asked them to do, he says, if you can do anything, will you help us? And Jesus says, if I can do anything, all things are possible for one who believes, Jesus told him. Remember what the man said? Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Help me in it. And I want you to take note of that, church, of what that man said. He was a man humbling himself before God, putting his mind in a position to be renewed. I mean, it pushes pride completely off the stage. It's a humbling thing. And he put his mind in a position away from what seemed possible, or maybe had seemed impossible to him prior to that, and toward what Jesus said is possible. Did you see? Jesus honored the man's acknowledgement of his weakness, his desire even to be renewed in his mind. That's what he's looking for in us. He's not saying, okay, once you get to this point, you're going to start seeing some changes. No, God says, when I see in your heart and in your mind a genuine, sincere desire to understand my ways as they go against the ways of the world, you're going to begin to see things happen differently in your life. So he honored this man's acknowledgement of his weakness, and he cast the demon out of his son, and he handed a transformed boy into the arms of a transformed father. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you may discern what is the will, the purpose of God. So as we close, I would draw your minds and your hearts to the alone time that Jesus knew his disciples needed. Because in that alone time, he explained to them again and again his purpose. The Son of Man will be delivered into the hands of evil men and be killed, and on the third day rise again. It was the purpose of the Father and the Son, and Jesus never wavered from it. Scripture says he set his face toward Jerusalem because that Jerusalem was waiting for him, a cross. Christ crucified, the event, which according to 1 Corinthians 1:23 has been for all these centuries a stumbling block to the Jews, foolishness to Gentiles, but to those who are called, Jews or Gentiles, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. How's it possible by way of a cross? How is that possible through death? Because God says it's the one way, the only way, by which sin is stripped of its power. The one means by which the devil has been dethroned. That's the purpose of God. And we see it everywhere in the life of Jesus. It's written down for you in the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. Study him. Listen to what he says. Look what he does. And we see evidence of that purpose today in people who have put their mind in a position to be renewed and their lives in a position to be transformed. It's a great time, church, to make that commitment or that recommitment, not only for graduates, but for every one of us. Would you pray with me? Jesus, help our unbelief. God, that's a powerful prayer. It's a humbling prayer, and yet it's one to which you respond. So God, I pray that again for every person who is sincerely with me in this prayer. Jesus, help my unbelief. And let me begin to see your ways fulfilled in my life to a greater extent. And give me the reminder every day that you are calling me to spend time alone with you. Amen. Our closing hymn is the reason all of this is important and all of it makes a difference. It's because he lives. He who once was dead lives. Let's sing together. youth who are going to the movie are leaving momentarily after the service. Okay. These words from the last paragraph of Paul's letter to the Romans. Now to him who is able to strengthen you according to my gospel and preaching of Jesus Christ, according to the revelation of the mystery that's been kept secret for long ages, but now has been disclosed through the prophetic writings, has been made known to all nations, according to the command of the eternal God, to bring about the obedience of faith. To the only wise God be glory forevermore through Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.